And now we will switch to the masterclass of the day, and that's presented today by Pauls Brust. Pauls has an almost 40 years of experience in the fashion industry as a CEO of CNA and recently as a pioneer of fashion and circular fashion economy, and also other projects on how to make the fashion industry a more and more sustainable industry. I found Pauls very inspiring, a very inspiring person with a lot of knowledge, and he's very passionate about changing the industry. And I'm sure you will enjoy his presentation. So Pauls, please proceed with the presentation.
Okay. Connection, so I hope you can understand me. I will share something. It's not working. So thank you for having me on board during this meeting or masterclass. I have to say a short introduction. And, I also like to thank the students with their inspiring presentations. There might be some overlap, and I think that's only good. That only proves that we are thinking in the same sustainable direction. So that's really very nice. But my name is Pauls Brust. I've been working for 38 years, but especially due to Rana Plaza and also due to a stakeholder mission with our Minister Ploemen in those days to Bangladesh as a result of this disaster over there. I was more interested in the sustainable fashion and aware of this due to the textile covenant, and that's the reason why I as a co-founder set by textiles, which will be in the presentation. I'm also genius behind Close to Circle. It's a consortium. It's a consortium with relevant players in the supply chain in the Netherlands under the coordination of the CSR. And what we would like to do is to find solutions with regard to circular textile problems, and especially when we talk about post-consumer material in the presentation. That's, last week we have established a new company which is called Simpact, part of Simpany, one of the biggest textile collectors in the Netherlands, and we try to create some impact there as well, which so in the presentation. So, where was I? Design for recycling. So I was happy having also three designers on board, because for us in the recycling industry, it is very, very important that you realize that whenever you're designing, take care already for recycling. Avoid virgin products and work also with these kind of post-production and post-consumer material. We, as far as our business is concerned, we were looking for the uses of post-production and post-consumer textile waste. And later on, I will share with you our journey. Also the uses of circular recycled yarns was for us a prerequisite to start the business. Also the environmental awareness, the use of organic cotton if virgin material was absolutely necessary. And of course, a clean and sustainable production also. And I've heard already a few things during the other presentations. We also would like to take care of the social labor circumstances into account. And we would like to prevent unworthy labor conditions, taking care for women's rights, production according to, and that was also in the presentation, the relevant United SDGs, which is absolutely possible also in countries like India. And last but not least, the transparency. I am so much in favor of transparency to avoid all these kind of greenwashing things, but also really for the end consumer to get a clear picture of what you're buying, because nobody is also at this moment, or even with these brands who are saying that they are very good and very sustainable, it's hardly to check and hardly to control. So there is a big, big improvement necessary if you would like to implement a new circular world. So that was for us also a prerequisite. And I'm also, due to my CNA background, I was very much interested also in the mainstream market. And why? Of course, it's very nice to develop all kinds of niche products and so on, but I really would like to make some impact and so on, and I would really to conquer the mainstream market, as we did, by the way, by CNA with working with organic cotton. CNA at the end became even world market leader with regard to organic cotton. So I'm very much in favor of three theories the 3H theory, which is not my own one. It's from IKEA, to be honest. They are saying, and referring also to the previous presentations, I was a little bit surprised by all these people who were really saying, I would like to purchase a sustainable article if it's 10 or 20% more. I really can tell you that also with my CNA experience, consumers first of all buy head. And price elasticity in the mainstream market is really an issue. So therefore we said, okay, if we would like to have an article, we would like to take into account these first A, which is the A of head. And we really need to give this consumer also a choice if it's for them affordable and if they can buy it. You know, everybody is aware in this world that driving in an electric car is a very useful thing. But if you only have Teslas available, not many people will do so. Very simple, just because they can't afford these kind of things. So I think the challenge in a sustainable world is that you offer those people in a mainstream market who always have to struggle with their budget at the end of the month, that they really can make a change, that they really can make a choice. So that was one of the things we would like to introduce. And the second thing is heart, of course. You can make all kinds of sustainable, very nice sustainable clothes or cars or whatever. But if people don't like it, and especially with clothes, if they don't like the print or the look and the feel, they are not going to buy it, even though it's very, very sustainable. I don't know any women or any men who said, you know, I look like shit, but it is sustainable. Nobody will do that. Nobody will do that. So always take into account, make it affordable, make it nice. And last but not least, take care for your hara. And hara is a Japanese word, so it has nothing to do with, it's not English or Dutch, but it means, do I owe you this? And I'm referring now to the CNA situation where we would like to implement the organic cotton. And I can tell you it was a big war with our buying department because the margins were a little bit different if you were using more of the same selling prices as a normal cotton. We started with baby wear, with rumpers, to be honest. And we said, okay, normally one rumper was $4.95 or something like that. And we said, okay, let's make it then $5.95. And the result, and why would we like to do that? Due to the fact that we said we would like to give them or consumers a choice. We also would like to have a nice product, and then we would like to use their Hara feeling. So what does that mean for a romper? Okay, now I have here something which I can, which is available for me, which I can really buy. I like it also, but the thing is, why should I spend my money to this thing? And taking models into account, they said, you know, that is very nice material. So it is no pesticides on the skin of my baby. And secondly, it's also very good for the environment. And that's what we call Hara. So then they owe you the money. And if these three sayings are correct, you can really conquer a mainstream market. So that was also for us a thing to take into account. And why then circular? And I think most of you will notice, and it's already tackled a little bit in the previous presentation, but taking only one pair of jeans into account and one t-shirt, and if you compare a recycled outfit to a virgin outfit, you're saving already for this simple set 8 kilos CO2. And if you're not using organic cotton, it's a saving also of 0.5 kilo of pesticides. And now it's around 10,000 liters of water. So that has to do with the cotton plant has to do also with cleaning, with ginning, dyeing, and so on and so on. So that is the situation for such a thing. And why a new setup with regard to the water? You just saw the enormous water consumption. But if you look to this overview, this is from the Dutch government in 1995, the situation, you can easily see that, but the prediction for 2025 is even more worse. And in fact, we are already there. Look to South Africa, there they have already many problems. But the most terrifying thing of this picture is if you look to the cotton production countries, you see they have already, or there is already scarcity with regard to water. You also should take into account that what I just showed you, that there is an enormous increase of mid-incomes. So, and there is also, of course, an increase in the textile/cotton industry. In other words, literally, we are drying out these countries. So we really need to do something, and therefore, recycling is so important. But there are, of course, more things. And that's also what I like very much about the presentation before. We also don't want to have anything to do with child labor in this total supply chain. One of the issues, of course, is also that you see lots of children working in a supply chain. But I can tell you for a company like C&A or H&M or Zara, it is less. I can even say it more bluntly. I think that only in very, very exceptional cases, there are not working children in their supply chain. The reason for this is that they are using audits. But I have news for you. These children are then not working in those factories where they are auditing, but they are working, of course, in other factories. And if we are even more doing, auditing and so on, yes, perhaps at the end, they are out of the supply chain. The child labor is not any more common in the textile chain. But did we really solve the problem? Of course not. Then they are working in a stone factory or in the stone industry, or even more worse, in prostitution or kind of thing. The real solution, to my point of view, is that we should really do something about labor wages and so on. Living wages is an issue. I don't think that on this planet that there are parents who said, I really would like to that my children are working. No, of course not. It's a matter of surviving. And if we are not willing to pay those people living wages, then this always will be a problem. And I think that is something we should realize. And those big companies, and I've been working for them, but one of the things is they will say to you, we are paying wages according to the local laws over there. They're paying the minimum wages according to local law. Okay, but that is taking Bangladesh, for example, into account. The minimum wage over there is 40-50% of living wages. So if you don't solve that problem, you will never solve these kind of things. And to give you an example, it's a little bit of a provocating example from the clean clothing company. But what is meant here is that what you see here, that if you have a t-shirt of $25, 58 cents is going to people who are working in a factory. If I present this to governments and so on, they're always nodding and say, oh yes, we have to do something about this. But look to the other red label, that is tax in Dutch, and that is also $4. So also they could do something, and they look at me and said, yeah, what could we do? So, well, of course, in your tenders or, you know, with taxes and so on, you could also do many things. And to give you one very odd example with regard to recycling, imagine that you have virgin cotton, you have to pay, of course, your VAT for this. But if we recycle it and use it for the second time, we have to pay again VAT. What is that? So these kind of things we should have to discuss with also governments, so then also business models can work in a more and in a better way. So this is something we would like to take into account. And also the very different labor conditions and also difficult labor conditions. These are pictures from India and Bangladesh where you see how people are working, and we would like to avoid that. And the same is, of course, this, and this is also nice from the dyeing and so on. Here you can see what kind of fashion colors we will have for 2021 and 2022, which is, of course, awful to see. So in other words, we would like to set up a company taking all these things as much as possible into account, and not having only a circular article where you have to be ashamed for, because there is still a label in it where one could see that's made in hell. That is something we would like to avoid, because we are urged to go in these low-cost countries due to the fact that we would like to make affordable things, but we also would like to make things where you can be proud of. So we said, okay, Upset Textiles, that would be the new company, and I'm the co-founder of Upset Textiles. Why Upset? Because we were upset by everything we saw, but we also would like to set up a new textile industry. So what we did was to look from what kind of possibilities we have with regard to recycling. First of all, chemical recycling, and the second thing was mechanical recycling. I think most of you know this. To say the highlights, chemical recycling is very expensive, and at the moment it is very much available, because most of it is still in the lab phase. But at the end, you will have a very good qualitative end product, which is most of the time cellulose. However, for starting up a business, this was too far in time for us. So we decided to choose another direction, mechanical recycling, in the beginning. But the biggest disadvantage of mechanical recycling is you're damaging the fibers, and you always need to blend due to the fact that you have damaged the fibers. And that was for us also something to take into account. However, the technique is available. You have possibilities of upscaling, but it is not really competitive with conventional fibers yet. But at that moment, there was not another choice for us. We also looked into two streams, the post-consumer stream and the post-production stream. Post-consumer, big advantage available in Europe, lots of kilos available. But the biggest disadvantage for us was the history of the garments. The uses of chemicals are not traceable. And that is a really big problem, because if you are not taking that into account and you would like to make a yarn and garments out of this, you cannot guarantee that you can wear it harmless on your skin. And this is something what was for us very, very difficult to accept, and also not workable and applicable. Post-production, so let's say textile waste from suppliers, there's a disadvantage. The sourcing area is in the Far East, so it's more kilometers you have to spend. But the biggest advantage, we know the history of these half fabrics, the clippings, they are known. And it is cheaper also per kilo compared to post-consumer, and is more easy to realize mono streams. And with mono streams, I do not mean singles. So it's the composition might be with cotton or with polyester and so on. But at the end, it should be one composition. But at the end, our final choice was a different one. We have chosen for pre-consumer or post-production, so cutting, really cutting waste. And then we came into contact with an organization which is called Purify, and they said to us, we are able to have organic recycling. It's a new method, as the Americans say, of rejuvenating fibers. And to be honest to you, I didn't believe it, because they were absolutely capable of rejuvenating in such a way without damaging fibers and so on, so that we really could use that again for in 100% quality. And we said this is too good to be true, so we did lots of tests and so on, and at the end it was really successful. And I will tell you that later on, because first of all, they are Purify, we are upset, and we would like to make things together. Purify is a Concordia in Belgium, and it's Purify Manufacturing. We are upset, as already told you. We are working together with Enview. These are circular venture builders also. And my business partner is Michel Walstock, and together we are upset. And what our plan is at the end is, we would like, together with Purify, we would like to set up a processing unit in India. This is the flowchart, but I think it's better to go to this side. What is now really our process? What is the pre-production process? We are collecting and sorting supplier cutting textile waste, and we would like to have clippings. We're capturing everything in an IT system. What's important for us, the composition, the color, and at the end, the finish. We will set up a hub facility for sorting, check, and storage, of course. And that is the input for the process. We need, in fact, first of all, black and white. And later on, we can also work, hopefully we can also work with colored textile waste, but the reason is we don't want to use at this moment chemicals which are not sustainable, and if we have to bleach at this moment, it is not sustainable. The second step, of course, is the output, that we have 100% rejuvenated fibers. Our roadmap is that we would like to have in 2019 we did our product validation. In 2020 we're still working on product and market validation, so we are looking for what is now the best to do. So as mentioned, and I hope that is explained in a good way, so the output are, of course, fibers 100% rejuvenated, but we are now investigating, is it better to trade in fibers, or having a collaboration with spinners to make yarns, or even health fabrics or products. It is obvious, of course, that the more value you're adding, the more commercial your product is also, and also your profit is better. In quarter three 2020, unfortunately, due to Corona, we will have our first production pilot line in Belgium. This pilot line will process around 3 million kilos in a year. And in quarter two 2021, we will have the real first production line in Belgium, and this will have a capacity of, let's say, 10 till 12 million kilos. And then, most important, together we in quarter two 2022 we would set up a processing unit in India, and that's a joint venture between Purify Manufacturing and Upset. And you might ask now, why not starting first in India, or why not doing that together? We first would like to have a rock solid pilot line over there, not making any mistakes. As mentioned in my slides, we also would like to go for the mainstream market and so on. So that means, unfortunately, we cannot with the production pilot, we cannot start with that, so we first go to the premium market. We have some Italian contacts also, especially the Dolce & Gabbana group, Louis Vuitton group, these kind of things. Spinning and weaving is most of the time done in Italy, and the first reactions of the spinners are very, very positive, and they really would like to collaborate. But our intention is, as mentioned here, to go at the end to India after this rock solid production also, and then we can really focus on these mainstream market. And why is mainstream then so important? This is what you see here. Our capacity we would like to set up with 4 lines, 48 million kilo of fibers per year. And now you can see the saving potential. It is 220 billion liters of water compared to virgin cotton. So therefore, this is such a sustainable project. And then taking into account what I just mentioned, that we are literally drying out these countries, this might be a great help for them. And of course, not only for them, but also for the total environment. Taking CO2 into account, then we will have the saving potential of 50 million kilos, and we need an investment of 20 million euros per line. You might consider that as a hell of a lot of money, but I can assure you that there are lots of, especially impact investors, who are really interested in setting up such a business together with us. The building conditions, we would like to have sustainable wherever applicable. And so we're working on a feasibility study now. Most probably we will be in Tamil Nadu in India, but we also will set up a factory over there where we have solar, where we have wind capacity and all these kind of things. So that's for us important, but even more important, we also look to the labor conditions over there. We would like to establish in an area where we can set up with the community all kinds of things according to the United Nations SDG. So we are heading to pay living wages. We would like to set up education facilities. We would like to set up also medical health together with them and so on, so that we really have a completely different way of processing these kind of things as it is nowadays in the textile industry. And we really would like to be an example over here from this point of view, but also from the environmental point of view. You cannot do these kind of things alone, so you need to have help over here. And therefore I'm so happy with the Dutch government, who is really supporting us, and Stichting Doen. This is a We have a famous lottery in the world, in the Netherlands, who's earning, who has lots of profits, but they also do lots of, they're supporting lots of sustainable initiatives and so on. And fortunately, also our initiative. This is one which I would like to show you as well. In our lab phase, we had we did lots of tests, and we had also. Tested some a blend with 65% cotton and 35% silk, and we had more than 200 kilos from this, and which was very successful. And then I was invited by the Dutch embassy to go to India to the trade mission, and our minister, she asked me, is there a possibility that I can wear something for you? And said, yeah, we only have a lab situation, which it doesn't matter. And together with one of our, well, you know, the designer Ronald van der Kolk, most probably, he was willing to help us. He designed this beautiful red dress, and I must say, the minister, she made press pictures. She also showed it to Mr. Modi, the Prime Minister in India, and she's really, really supporting us. The bag, by the way, which you see there, is made of felt, which is a post-consumer material. And we had some leftover material, so we also during the trade mission, this minister Bruins, he said, is there a possibility for having suits as well? And I said, of course, we can make a suit for you. And the story goes even further, because our Prime Minister, Mr. Rutte, said, I would like to have it for my total group, but fortunately we did not have that material for it. So otherwise we could have served the total Dutch government. Unfortunately, not possible. We were very proud that already in this stadium they're supporting us like this. So that was upset, but there is more. Next to this, I just said, okay, this is textile waste from suppliers and so on, but we still have this huge problem of post-consumer material. And we would like to set up also something over there. And this is our dream with regard to post-consumer material. we would like to, of course, you have to sort that and so on, but we would like to use the, especially when you're talking about the closed loop, then it might be possible in future that we can also use that in our process as well in Belgium, as well in India. And why is that? Because then the history is quite well known. And in hospitality, you can think of sheets and so on. And we think that we can also rejuvenate this kind of material. The biggest problem is, of course, if you have washed this several times, what is the quality of the fiber? Is it still strong enough? But if not, we can use it most probably in non-woven. And on the other hand, there will also be some recycling, of course, will be done in the Netherlands, where you can also have some yarns or fibers, and then later on yarns. And we think that later on we can combine it with our process. And then you have, of course, other material which you cannot use. I think you all know the Carter Bible, where it is mentioned that only at this moment 1% of the textile which is produced is also coming back to the textile industry. With this, we can increase, of course, this percentage a lot. On the other hand, I think we should remain realistic as well. There will also be a big quantity which cannot go back into the textile industry. But therefore, you need to think of several solutions as well. We are doing that, but first of all, what are then the barriers of the textile recycling? Well, that is, first of all, still there is 120, 170 million kilos thrown away in our daily garbage and so on, and not collected. So that is something we should really increase or decrease these numbers. The cost price is still, and they still call it waste, but I prefer to talk about raw materials, but because there are raw materials. The monostreams, creating of monostreams is difficult. Also finding appropriate funding of innovation improvement for example, sorting techniques. And that the reason for this, that you are dealing, of course, with commodities. So it's not very profitable. It's very difficult to add value on that. So it's very difficult to find also investors for this. Analyzing used chemicals, that's something we need to know at the end. And of course, the cost price and so on, which is important. Well, the solution is our new company, which is called Simpact. We would like to make very much impact, and also we will act according to this. Well, this is obvious, I think. And this is one of the last sheets already. Here you can see, I think it's difficult for you, but this is a little bit, what is now exactly the post-consumer model and where you're focusing up on. We are focusing on post-consumer, but also on workwear, house textiles and hospitality, and also the leftovers. And what you see here in green, and that is of course what these collectors do at the moment, it is reusing. So secondhand is of course one thing with this. You enlarge also the life the life period of an article, and repurpose is also a possibility. In between, you see also the yellow ones. So this is a let's say mono stream, so only one of a there can be more of it's one composition of the article. I give you an example here of cotton. What we can do is mechanical, organic, and also chemical recycling. This is of course I think for will 10 or 20%, but we still have the problem that lots and lots of post-consumer material will be burnt or will be used for automotive insulation material and so on, which is downcycling. Therefore it's in red, and we are looking for solutions to do that more in a circular way and to do more upcycling. Our first lab steps at the moment, which are very promising, is we're working with 50% and 50% foil granulate, alternative for wood and shore blocking and sound walls. Very promising, because the additional thing which we did not take into account is that if you use textile and foil granulate together, or foil together, you also have some noise reduction, which is very applicable for sound walls. We are working also on substitution for MDF boards. That is, of course, not so surprising because wood is, of course, also cellulose. And, you know, organic fibers are also cellulose, especially when you talk about cotton and so on. We are even working with also here in Amsterdam with a party who is working for an alternative with regard to traffic road signs. and they would like to try out if acrylic and viscose could be used for that as well. And last but not least, and that's also again something which is a sneak preview, we're working also with fancy greens. We're working for so-called the overall green solution. And what is that? It's a very nice idea of several parties. You can also use that for sound walls. We will use all photo granulate for, let's say, for the framework. We will use a kind of green blanket, which we use also in combination with that. And what's the and the sorry? And there is a, the green blanket has some has a mixture of different plants where you also can realize the following: they absorb nitrogen and CO2, and they're also stimulating biodiversity. So at the end, we have with this kind of fences, we will have a solution for textile waste, for noise absorption, for nitrogen, for biodiversity, and of course for well-being, because if you look now really to these fences and so on, or to sound walls, they're so ugly and with gravity and all kinds of things. But if they're green, it's a completely different look, but also for the well-being of people. This was an initiative of an architect and so on, and we have presented it now to Schiphol, and even to there are some conversations with the National Road Railway Company, and also with the province in the Netherlands, who are very interested in these kind of things. So this might be one of the things which will be very interesting in future. And I think what you see also here, all these solutions are also volume solutions to create the impact. So that's more or less in a nutshell what I'm doing. I did it very rapidly to take the time into account. I hope it was clear. If you want more info, you can always contact me. Thank you for your attention. If you want to ask questions, please feel free to do so.
Thank you very much, Paul. Very interesting. Thank you. Cristiano, can I start with the question?
Yes. Absolutely. I like a lot. I learn a lot. I mean, I of course I know always some of the details of all the presentation, but really this this tale basically by Paul is a personal tale. I mean, there's a real story of what he's doing. So it's extremely, extremely interesting, because it was very detailed, something that is not a dream or something like that, something that is a real project. So, wow, very interesting. I also mentioned Symphony, and we work with Symphony. We try to begin something, a project with the student this year. So,
interesting. Yeah.
It's interesting.
You were talking about that the production line in Belgium, and actually the production line in Belgium would be operational in the end of this year probably, yeah?
Yes, that's correct.
It's just for the fabrics, but then the aim is, the target is the luxury market. Why the luxury market?
That is due to the fact that, that's a good question, that is due to the fact that the output of the pilot line is of course more expensive than estimated later on. And that is due to the fact that we do foresee that we have to change things, that we have to stop the machines again, that the recipe has to change and so on. So therefore, it is really very, very, but it is much more expensive. And we all do believe that if we are, if we would like to sell this to people who are in the mainstream market, they will not be interested due to the price elasticity.
So there will be a kind of special collection for those luxury brands.
Yeah. And also you have to take into account that textile waste in Europe is not, taking the volumes into account, is not that much. So we need to import lots of fibers out of India, which also means that the transport costs are included. So that is also one of the reasons. that it is a little bit more expensive. Yeah.
I'm sure we will have a couple of meters for some of the students to make a collection. Paz, there are a couple of questions. It's easier if you can read yourself. I don't know if you can, if you go on the three dots on the bottom of the screen, more option, and you click on the three dots, that's on the top, the Q&A section. If you click on Q&A, you should see on the right a panel with the questions. Is it correct?
I try it again.
The three dots, then the Q&A, and when you click Q&A, there should be a panel. There are two or three questions for you.
Yeah.
From Meatab, I believe. Are you think technology is going to help in circularity, for example, in waste management or in growing tech innovation in blockchain?
Yes, that's also something I could have told. So what we are doing at the moment is that we have a discussion with the supplier. We would like to have tracking and tracing in our fibers as well. This tracking and tracing is first of all for that cannot cheat during the process that the weaver is doing, is adding other material and so on and selling it for 100% recycled. That's one thing, but we also later on think that due to this tracking and tracing and also working together or working but implemented in a kind of blockchain, we can even avoid showrooming. You know what showrooming is, that they show you a nice factory, here and here everything is processed and it will be done somewhere else. So we will have equipment in the factory over there where we also can prove that this really has been processed in this factory. In this factory, we would like to implement an open door policy also so that you can always, without even making an appointment, that you can come into this factory and so on, and you can check and do everything and to prove it to the consumer. Next to this, we also are working on, it was too much for the presentation, I'm sorry for that, but we're also working with, we would like to work on some consumer labels and so on, showing them what is the content of the recycling, what is the saving potential, what is the saving has been. But even more important, we are, next to this, we are working also to the footprint and to the LCA. So we really would like, and that's a little bit less interesting for consumers, but it is interesting in the business to business. Because if you buy volumes, then you can really show to your end consumer at the end by having used this kind of recycled material, so many kilos we have saved, so many this we have saved, so many that, compared to the virgin materials and so on. So that is what we take into account. Yeah.
Have you already idea of the cost of the final product compared to a regular material, cotton?
Yes. Perhaps it's a little bit more expensive, but we can compete with virgin cotton in such a way that I cannot compete with the Primark and H&M and the CNA entry price points, of course. But let's say that a normal T-shirt, not the cheapest ones, is let's say $7.95 or something. I'm convinced that we can for $9.95 or something like that, or $11.95, something like that. So it is in the neighborhood of that. Yeah.
So it means that there were the possibilities, there were the technology, several technology. What was needed, someone like you and your partners to join all these dots together. Basically, because usually you hear it's not possible, it's too expensive, it's too far in the future. So of course we are not expert, and we believe we can say all these things, but now it's getting to a reality.
It is the only thing what is not so nice here. I'm not the owner of the intellectual property, so you're always dependent on what your partners would like to do. And that's one thing. And the other thing is, and we also would like to a transparent chain. And that is something also, if you want to set up something very circular and so on, collaboration in the chain is necessary. And I think that's also quite new against to traditional working in the supply chain, collaboration, sharing things with each other, and so on. That's the way to go forward, and not keeping everything for yourself, not willing to disclose things, and so on. I think that is something we should also learn in the new circular economy.
So definitely a completely different business model, but also completely different approach, basically to an industry and a new industry. Ladies, do you have any question maybe related with your dissertation that still you couldn't, as you say, clarify while you were searching? Any of you? And let me see, we have a last comment or question. Let me open somewhere. I cannot find it now, but I will find it.
It's from Sander.
From Lucia Antico, probably from Italy. It's in the chat. Very interesting presentation. Thank you. Another trend in circular fashion economy is to use waste of other industry to produce textile fiber. For example, there are companies which are using waste from oranges to produce fiber similar to silk. Salvatore Ferragamo used this for the 2017 collection. What do you think about this approach of using other recycling? I mean, this is what Maria Sole was presenting at the beginning.
Yes. Yeah, I think these developments are also very, very interesting, and so on. So far, I've seen lots of these developments. The thing is, they are at this moment focusing on a niche market because it's more expensive than traditional material, and so on. But I think at the end, this will be scalable as well. And another thing which has not mentioned in the presentation, but working with orange peels and so on, there is pectin inside. And pectin can help us very, very much with regard to if you're having polyester and nylons with these microfibers and so on, it is binding the fibers and so on, this pectin. So also there is the connection with the traditional textile and so on. And we can really do something then also with polyester.
Super, super interesting. I believe there's no more question in the Q&A, in the chat.
Sander has a question.
Where is Sander? Okay, so you see it. I don't see it, but if you see it, you can answer.
Yeah, Sander is asking the IMVO conference. I researched a while ago, there was some critique on the attention for animal welfare. Are there any well-vested parties within the industry pipeline already working with this topic? I really don't know, but I know there is some criticism with regard to this covenant from animal welfare. And that might be right as well, but I think the steps which have been done now already, so having all these, it's 50-60% of the total textile industry in India, in the Netherlands on board. They were obliged to disclose the suppliers already, and they're working now towards, let's say, a kind of due diligence, that they really have to come up with new plans and so on, how to make their supply chain more transparent, and where to improve it with regard to social welfare and these kind of things. So yes, we are not there, but I think this is really a first step into a very good direction, and you can criticize it, which is also everybody can criticize, but also look into the good things so far, because this is better than we had. Much better, I think.
Yeah. Definitely.